Hi folks, and welcome back to the workshop. One of those jobs I've been wanting to do for a while on WRD is to fit an extra fuel tank. I do sometimes take it further afield, and what with the fuel consumption, it's quite useful to have a bit of extra range. You'd be surprised, particularly sitting on the motorway, just how quickly the petrol gauge drops. Particularly going away to steam rallies, I every now and again go to ones further afield, and it would be nice just to be able to fill up at home and make the round trip without having to worry about finding somewhere to come home again. Particularly at the moment, you know, we've got this E10 fuel. I'm very lucky actually, a chain of local garages that supply ethanol free fuel, so that's quite convenient. But also at the moment, with the unpredictability of it, all these environmental nutters blocking the tanker depots and so on, which is a blooming nuisance, it's quite nice just to know that you're going to be able to make a longer journey there and back and not worry about it. This is a reproduction tank, but with an original cap and filler neck. Might restore the cap eventually. And original pickup pipe, which I've soldered a new filter on. Just about a 50 litre tank. We've got a fuel sender. And we've got the changeover valve. I've been collecting up bits for this for quite a while. I thought I'd got everything until this morning. I discovered I was missing a union, so I made that up, and that is going to have some flexible pipe and be the connection to the new tank. So that'll be the one to the fuel pump, and that'll be the one from the rear fuel tank. These little valves were military fitment. Nice simple E-knots brass taps. They've got a cork seal in, so best avoid E10. That does actually attack cork seals. The cork seals are available from Blanchard's. These have two little changeover switches. I believe the originals were the same as Jaguar E-type handbrake switches, if you're looking for them. But I couldn't find a cheap source of them. They were quite expensive. It was going to be like 50 quid for a pair of switches. So I got a pair of brake light switches at £4 each and modified the bracket to fit them. For the time being, I'm not actually going to wire up the sender. I don't really need it. But they're there if ever I want to do that. As for the pipe work, again, some of that can be quite expensive. You can get it all, but the auxiliary tank 2 valve, which is only a short length of pipe, it's this kind of style made up plastic pipe. They wanted about £50 for that. So I've just bought a length of rubber fuel hose, and that is going to go onto that, and then a hose barb on the tank. But we have got the proper one, which comes from the rear fuel tank. It's got all the right connections on it. This one here is tapped to fuel pump, and then I've also got a new one from the fuel pump to carburetor, so all that will be replaced. These fuel cylinders are universal. They're designed to fit the various different Land Rover tanks, of which there are of course many and various types. So what they do, they supply the sender unit with just a straight rod on it, a bit of wire, and then this other piece that the float clips to, and then two little metal clips, and the idea is that you can clip the two together and set whatever length you need. But they don't work. So what I've done with mine is just to solder the clips in place, so that's all now ready to fit. Very easy to do, but you'll just need some decent flux to solder steel wire together. So I'm just starting to look at where the auxiliary fuel tank's going to go. And you can see the main fuel pipe from the rear tank where that runs, so that's actually going to be changed. The fuel tap goes about there. This is my cable to the load bay winch I use for loading the stationary engines. Believe it or not, the tank's so tight to the seat box I've had to unclip it, put it in some smaller conduit, about half the diameter that I'd used. I must have used what I had at the time. See it down there? There's the thicker stuff. See the difference? so it might just give enough room. But I get the feeling that I'm actually going to have to run this higher up around the seat box. So I'm going to do a trial fit of the tank and see where we are. So it attaches to that cross member there, or outrigger rather. And then we've got the extra one for the fuel tank there, which was not standard fitment on this vehicle, but something I specified with the new chassis. So I'm going to need to remove the stay for the fold down step, but that will be able to go back. It'll just sit over the bracket for the fuel tank, and we're going to have lots of fun getting the bolts up in there. The tank's not particularly heavy, so I was able to lift it into position and then pop a couple of axle stands underneath just to hold it in place. The front bolt holes line up, the rear one doesn't. We'll come back to that. So I've wiggled the tank into just the right position where I can see at least the front bolt holes line up. The problem is we've got an aftermarket chassis and an aftermarket tank, so you know, it was always going to be the way. Basically the rear bolt hole essentially needs to move further forwards, so I think I'm just going to have to file it out to fit. But we can make that work. But you can see it's close here where the filler neck is. I've got the seat right back. This one's adjustable, so you can pull it right forward. But you can get the filler cap off. You can actually, with the seat forward, pull the filler neck out, so that all works fine. I think there was a different panel, but I don't really want to take all the seat base off for that. Not necessary. I can see the run of the cable now, so the cable for the winch is going to have to run higher up along the front. There's space right up the top, and then it can drop back down onto the clips because there's a bit of space at this corner. I can clip it back along as I head it, and then it will come back out in the right place. So that'll all work out quite nicely. I can still get in there to reach the tap, which the tap has to go just there, so that should all work. That's the petrol tank in. It wasn't too much of a fight in the end. Kind of odd, but it's almost like it's too tall. The lid, the seat box cover, actually sits on top of that, which is kind of annoying. I think what I'm going to do is put some different fixings in these two and just add some little thumb screws or something to hold it down. It doesn't need anything special for the time being, but anyway, there is a proper seat box with a catch, like the one you can see over there for the passenger side, so I might sort all that out in time. So now I've got to look at putting the tap in, which goes down there. Just show you the fixings underneath. Rather than using the fixings that came with the kit, I've used some stainless M8 bolts. This might make removing the tank, if ever that's necessary, a little bit easier. Just drilled out the stay for the step, and that's all perfectly good. Nice bit of clearance around it. Actually, it has fitted quite well. It's not really rubbing anywhere. And up the back, you've got a single bolt with rubber mounts. So you tighten the nut as much as it will go, and it bottoms out on the shank of the bolt, just compressing the rubbers a bit. I'm sure they'll need replacing soon enough, but it's all rigid, worked out. But it just allows the tank to flex. So of course the chassis in these moves a bit. Anyway, it has worked out. So there's the petrol tap. I made a very simple template just to give me the sensors to drill on. Just check that my handbrake lock still fits with that in its correct position, and it will, so that's fine. Nice bit of room down there, so actually it's better than I thought it was going to be. I was fortunate to be able to take the tap off of a military seat box all complete. It was the type that had a fuel tank under the passenger side and the driver's side, both tanks up the front. You can see the tap is mounted with the two outlets, or rather, sorry, the two inlets, so pipe from each tank underneath. Incidentally, if the tap handle is swung to the right or near side, offside rather, it'll do the offside connection. If the tap handle is swung to the near side, it'll do the near side connection. So that's useful to remember. Anyway, you can see where it goes, right near the handbrake assembly. Basically, to the left of the handbrake mount. Hard on it, basically. I'm going to put like a 3/4 inch hole in the seat box for the hole cutter. We've got this acoustic matting stuff as well, so that makes it a bit more difficult. But it should all work out. And you can see the latch there for the sliding lid, like on the toolbox. So we might do something about that. But anyway, useful to see how it goes, and gives you some idea of the condition of that tap as well. Before I restored it, it was quite rough. So there you go. So all I'm going to do is, using the little template and this bracket, just put some paint pen marks on there where I want to drill. And the tap fitted. Should be a big rubber grommet in there, so I need to try and find something for that. I'll probably find something that will go in the seat box, tucked behind this matting stuff, but we'll come back to that. Just trying to get it all up together and working today. And I just need to put a little bend on my pipe stub that I made yesterday. Just bring that up a bit, and that one is going to come off the auxiliary tank here. I've actually just moved the position of the tap slightly higher up, about half an inch higher up, to help me get the handbrake lock on. There is room to do that. Clearance for the cables fitting there, and if anything, it just gives a bit more underneath, which is quite helpful. So that's worked nicely. Just make sure it clears the handbrake. Nothing anywhere near, so we're all good. So really, the correct position is right slap bang on the middle of this bracket. You can see I've moved it up about half an inch. Well, I think I'm at the point now where I can chuck some fuel in it. I've just made up all the pipes, fitted them up. The only one I had to make was the onto the auxiliary tank. So swing the tap to the right for that one. I think I said before you could get the hard line, the original version, but it was like 50 quid. I wasn't prepared to spend that. This is biofuel hose, which is what I use now. Really good stuff. So this is the one that goes to the fuel pump. That fitted fine, that was the correct part. It's hard up against the petrol tank, so I'm just going to get some sticky back neoprene, stick that against the tank just to stop that fizzing and vibrating. Easy enough to take that one off to get the tap out. The bottom two probably best removed with the tap out. I've been able to tighten them up, but it is tight in there. This is the one that goes to the rear tank. Again, that was a special part number for this conversion, and it's picked up on all the original securing clips and so on, and fitted perfectly, so I'm very pleased. As you can see, I ran the cable to the winch along the chassis. In the end, I decided it was better to be able to get to that. And it's in a nice safe location there. Anyway, all in all, I think that's worked out quite well. So, yeah, pretty happy with it. I'm going to chuck some fuel in and see if it will run on it.
Well, there was a little leak on the auxiliary tank line. Couldn't get the union tight enough with it, with the tap fitted. I've taken it out and nipped it up a bit more. Could just see it bubbling around the top of the union, but it's okay now. Appears to have been successful. I'll give it 5 minutes and pass judgment then.
Well, that all appears to be okay. One thing that is apparent is that the cork seal is going to probably weep a little bit to begin with. It will need to swell up a bit. and I should probably get some of those to carry in the spares kit as well. Anyway, it seems to be successful. No leaks. One thing I do just want to do is tie that petrol pod off just slightly better, but for now it's pretty good. So I'm just going to work out a way of affixing that seat box cover in some sort of quick release fashion. Grubby under there. I'll get the hose pipe in there and flush it all out sometime, but anyway, it doesn't really matter. One of my jobs is actually to give the floor a bit of renovation. I need to take it up and replace these braces. They're not too bad, but they're a bit rusty now. One thing I'm going to do today is just replace this line, put it somewhere else so that the sender's got a good earth as it is over reading at the moment. But no leaks from the fuel pipe. All good. So I've been driving the Rover a bit this week. I just thought I'd follow up the previous video. No issues so far. Going along very nicely on the fuel tank, the new fuel tank. I can't see any leaks from anything, so I'll be keeping an eye on it, but all seems okay. I just wanted to show you this. There's a few people on the Series Land Rover Facebook group have been asking about this. But if you go on the Pangolin 4x4 website, you can find the auxiliary fuel tank kit, and they've published the list of parts that you need. Now, most importantly are the fuel pipes. But anyway, if you head there or freeze the screen, you can see something of what you need. In terms of all these fixings, you really, you know, you can sort of make up the rest as you go. In terms of my vehicle, I haven't done the seat box extension. You can take the seat frame off, change the top panel on the seat box, have the sliding lid, all of that. I may do that at some point, but it's a lot of extra expense, and it's not actually strictly necessary. You can see the price of their kit. You could knock the one and the rest off that for what it cost me. So anyway, I hope that's useful to someone. I've just got a couple of new seals from Blanchard's today. These are XMOD old stock. They're about £9 each, a lot of money, but from past experience it's worth having the right thing. There's some really cheap ones on eBay, but from the photos they look like completely the wrong material, far too coarser grained material. This is a really fine grained cork, and you know, good quality stuff. I think well worth having, and they'll be chucked in the toolbox should ever they be needed. All being well, going to Brooklands for the classic car driving this weekend, about a 150 mile round trip, so that'll be a good test of all the recent work. Anyway, hope you've enjoyed the video, and thank you for watching.